Did you see any new plant problems while you were doing your job last year? Sometimes you are the first people to notice a new pest problem. This scenario happened in the Pacific Northwest the last couple of years. The story of the winter cutworm as a problem in Oregon and Washington is an example of how important it is to report new plant problems that you see in the field. You can get an accurate identification from a university diagnostic lab or researcher. This is sometimes the spark that initiates monitoring of the problem and research on the pest and management options. You may even be the one to help prevent establishment of the pest in Washington. Winter cutworm lawn damage was first reported by a homeowner in Oregon.
So the story of winter cutworm in Oregon starts in February of 2015 when I received a ask an expert question from a homeowner in Portland, Oregon. The homeowner had already identified the cutworm or misidentified it as an army worm and sent some pictures that were pretty blurry and hard to ID. And I'd never heard of army worm problems in Oregon, so I was obviously very interested, but because of circumstances, never got the chance to go visit the site, and the damage had already been done. It was a new lawn that had been planted the previous fall. So fast forward to October of 2015, and I received an email and a video of a homeowner in Banks with a picture of their lawn half eaten and a nighttime video showing cutworms crawling all over the place. So I immediately wanted to go visit and see if I could find out what the insect was. So I drove up to Banks and met with the homeowner and collected specimens. I then brought them back to Oregon State University and gave them to Jessica Green for ID. So the damage I saw to the lawns was quite remarkable because it was a line of foliage being eaten across the whole entire lawn. And the cutworms effectively ate through this lawn in a few days. So that's, for a homeowner, that's quite remarkable. The good side of the story is they're surface feeders and they feed at night, so they will be easy to kill if that becomes necessary. My guess is that the high populations in this case were due to the extreme weather pattern that we had over the past year with incredibly dry, warm climate, which produced a spike in populations. Now, of all the cases I've heard about, there were approximately 6 in Oregon and 6 in Washington on lawns and turf landscapes. So the damage has been, in terms of scope, has been fairly minimal. I only heard of 1 or 2 golf courses with very small damage to collars and approaches. So the golf courses have yet to become really a big target. The other thing about winter cutworm is that they have a wide host range, so they're feeding on a lot of agricultural crops, which may actually benefit turf because they're not going to feed just only on turf grass. In terms of the future, it's always difficult to predict, but my guess is we'll see localized hot spots from time to time. And from a landscape perspective, a landscape professional perspective, where you're only visiting a site once a week potentially, if it's a perfect storm, you could show up on a site a week later and have the grass half eaten. So that's potentially a concern. So scouting in October is when the feeding occurs is really, or being vigilant in October is really important.
Turf damage is only part of the story with the winter cutworm. It has been observed in a variety of crops, so other faculty at Oregon State University have also been researching this pest.
I'd be happy to tell you about winter cutworm, the yellow underwing. It was pretty amazing in the fall of 2015. We went out into a perennial rye down in Shedd, Oregon. And as I was walking in the field, I was seeing larvae, very large larvae, probably their last instar, their last stage of life. Most of them, probably greater than 90%, were very mature. They were moving just like an army through the field. And as I studied them, when I first looked at them, I thought they were army worm. So I collected those, brought them back, spent many, many hours under scope. My initial thought was spotted cutworm. And as you start looking closer, they didn't have this triangular stripe coming down the sides of their bodies, but it was very much like a dash coming across the top. And then I saw there's these sutures that run down the head. And you can see there's this frontal one and an epi one. And I thought, this is a cutworm, not an army worm. So there's a really good insect clinic here. I walked over to a guy named Bill Girth. And this is, and I brought him my book and was saying, this, Bill, you gotta help me confirm this. It doesn't look like any of the ones that we've had here, but I've seen the same one in my yard and just haven't had a chance to look at it. And it happened to be, Bill then dissected it and we saw the mandibles, and those are the teeth, and they're very, very prominent. You don't see that in army worms. Pretty evident that it was the winter cutworm. The same day that I brought in these larvae, in a family of moths called the noctuids. As a child, I used to call them the Miller moths because they'd show up at your lights at night, very drab colors, the gray, the brown. But they each, when you take a very closer look, either have crescents or watermarks. And in this case here, if you look underneath the wings, very orange with a nice band, black band on the underwing. So very distinguishable feature. This winter cutworm is very cold tolerant, as you probably all well know. We found them way late in the season. In the spring, right around March, we saw these guys creating these earthen cells, and there was pupae in the soil, in which later they emerge, and that's when I started seeing moths, seeing this underwing moth emerge in the spring, right around May, and some very early June this year. But in the fall, they were probably looking for a place to then hibernate, look to rest until spring. And the impact in the fall, we saw a lot of damage that was done on some of that fall, the fall seedlings, in which very little yield loss maybe in the spring. So I think it's very important, once we had the real correct identification of the winter cutworm, and the more we read a little bit on some of its life biology, and probably research really needs to happen on its behavior and what are its vulnerable stages, and knowing that there's probably biological control out there that are keeping in its check. And a person might question, you know, why did it show up this year? It could have been something to do with climate, or that migration was very favorable because of the very warm, but we had some wetness and the eggs survived that were laid in the weeds that are bordering and surrounding some of these fields. So I think it's really critical to really do our homework and really do research and understanding what could happen in the Pacific Northwest. And it happened this year was very mild, a very mild winter. We got a lot of rain in the spring, but we didn't see the damage that we thought we might expect. So, you know, a grower asks, you know, hey, what can I do? I'd like to be better prepared this next year. And I think, too, understanding that life cycle and knowing that you could have two flights and that they could be out there laying eggs. And a lot of it is in a line or a mass on some of the weeds. And to really start looking for the larvae very early in the season, in the fall. So when you're out in the field, monitoring is really key. And, you know, we didn't know what to expect. Anything can happen at any time with some of these new invasives, even like spotted wing. It was, we had a symptom, and we had to do a little bit of homework on its life history, its biology. And the more we know about the behavior and the movement and what its susceptible stages are, then more we can really create a management plan for the winter cutworm.
The researchers at Oregon State University have worked together to better understand the winter cutworm and its potential for crop damage. The Willamette Valley is a major vegetable growing region in Oregon. OSU has been monitoring insect pests for years in the VegNet program. The winter cutworm was found causing damage in the vegetable crops.
My first exposure to winter cutworm was when Brian McDonald of the turf program at OSU brought it to my office. He needed a positive ID for this potential pest. He'd been seeing it in turf grass. It was causing problems. So I was able to ID it as Noctua pronuba, which is called the winter cutworm. The part that made it unusual was that we have had the adult moth in this region for up to a decade, but it's never been documented as causing agricultural problems. The unique thing about winter cutworm is its life cycle. So it is called the winter cutworm because it's actually actively foraging during the fall and winter months, which is of consequence here because we have so many different crops growing throughout those months. The potential for crop damage from the larvae exists from September through March, which is a very long season for potential damage. And it also has an extremely wide host range, everything from forage and turf grasses to fall-seeded brassicas, ornamentals. Once we were able to identify the pest as winter cutworm, we actually started observing it in many other crops. Specifically, this fall I was working in turnip and forage rape fields, other brassicas, anything really that's actively growing throughout the winter. The cutworm was found in these fields to be causing defoliation and also, in the case of grass and pasture land, quite large swaths of damage. Some of the other crop pests that we can detect with OSU's VegNet program include variegated cutworm, black cutworm, cabbage looper, diamondback moth, many of these typical suite of bad pest issues for growers in the Willamette Valley. We have a regional trapping and monitoring system with 8 to 10 sites from north to south. And via that, we can detect when there's an outbreak of a certain type of pest. And also the strength of the program is that we can relate it to prior years to determine if it's actually a problem or how big of an influence it might be for the growers. The VegNet program is actually in its 20th year of operations, so we're pretty excited about that. It gives us a really good way to detect patterns of these pest species. We use these pheromone traps as a monitoring tool. They're very specific, so each trap attracts a different type of moth, and then we can compare those patterns of activity, flight activity, and estimate when there might be egg laying and then subsequently larval pressure. And the larval pressure is when the growers would see the problem in their crops.
After the winter cutworm story started in Oregon, later that same year in Washington, turf damage from the pest was diagnosed.
So I am the plant diagnostician as well as the insect identifier here at WSU Puyallup's Plant and Insect Diagnostic Lab. Back in the summer of 2006, we got a picture in of this very brilliant colored moth. And it was something that the entomologists there at WSU Snohomish County had not seen before. The moth itself, when it just lay on the ground, was a drab brown moth, just like any other you'd see. But when it flew off, the underwings were revealed to be bright orange and they had these black lines on it. And it was, you know, very striking, and he knew right away that he had never seen it before. So I forwarded the pictures to Dr. Eric Lagasa at Washington State Department of Ag, and he took a look at them and he wrote back to tell me that Jenny, that he had something called the yellow underwing moth. And this moth he had already seen once that year because someone had collected it out of a sample up in the Blaine, Washington area. And he started looking into it and discovered that it was a problem pest status. You know, lawns were a big concern. So for the next couple years, we'd get one or two of them in. And every time I'd mow my lawn, not every time, but, you know, often I'd see one of these underwing moths fly away as I was mowing. Yet we never got any lawn damage in. It was just there, you know, not seeming to cause a problem. So that's how the story went for about 5 or 6 years. Well, last fall, 2015, I got these pictures of this brand new lawn, and it was very close to here. It was a just fresh laid sod, And the client called up to say that the plants were dying, it looked terrible, and that there were these army worms. He kept saying army worms, which are a type of cutworm. And I said, well, army worms won't do the problem. I mean, they eat, but they're not lawn pests. And then I got the pictures and I opened them up, and the first thing that I was struck by was the very linear pattern of the damage on this lawn. The lawn was beautiful in the center, and all around the edges there was this dead brownish look to it. And it was very, very sharp line. I mean, there was just a straight line on three sides of the lawn where this problem was. So to me, these pictures clearly said that this was actually not going to be a pest problem at all. It was something abiotic or non-living. So I was asking questions about pesticides, such as herbicides, what the watering had been like, where on the bundle the roll was. I mean, I had all sorts of ideas because I was focusing on those stresses because of the pattern. We got another sample in, and this client started out with, hey Jenny, I thought we oversprayed, but I looked at my records and we did not. I went out and investigated, and what did I find? All these larvae, these worms. And so at that point, finally the big light bulb went on in my head, and it's like, okay, everything people are saying is right. Those insects are connected to the problem. And one of my colleagues said, hey Jenny, have you heard about the fact that they're finding this cutworm down in Oregon, Noctua pronuba? And I'm like, the yellow underwing moth? Yeah, that was what it was again. And sure enough, we sent the samples off. They were confirmed to be this. The larvae is now being called the winter cutworm, so two names for the same thing. But this is what's going on. We had 10 or 15 very scattered throughout Western Washington sightings of this, and we realized it was a much bigger problem than we'd really heard. So we're keeping our eyes out for, fall 2016. We're curious as what we're gonna see.
It was a keen observer with practical field experience who led to the winter cutworm diagnosis.
I was contacted by one of our customers around Thanksgiving in 2015 and to come out and check and advise on some damaged turf. It was in the 176 and Meridian area on South Hill in Puyallup. Upon coming out to the property and inspecting it, we saw damaged turf all around the perimeter. It appeared to be herbicide leaching damage was our first initial thought. Found out there had been no chemicals applied to the property, so we dug a little deeper. We found a large larva underneath the edge of the damaged area of the turf. The turf would pick up like a piece of carpet or rug, and there were a sufficient number of these larvae. They appeared to be a cutworm type of insect. Gathered up some, took them over to Jenny Glass at the WSU plant lab. She forwarded them to an entomologist who had identified them as a Noctua pronuba or large underwing moth. Since that time, I had found other cases of that insect or pest on South Hill, heard about them in the Olympia Lacey area, Kent, Renton, Marysville, Stanswood. So it's been all up and down Western Washington from what we're hearing. The other interesting thing to note is that during the warm part of the day, they were on top of the turf feeding on the crown. And in the cool of the evening or the morning, they were underneath the turf feeding on the roots. So a pretty versatile pest and could be capable of doing some damage in sufficient numbers.
There are other communications and connections that help solve these mystery problems. Often, several people in the field and the labs must work together to accurately diagnose a problem. Sharing that information with the growers and homeowners is an important next step.
So Martin had gone to the job site as well and took a sample to the Washington State University for a complete diagnosis or a DNA sampling, and it was determined to be the winter cutworm. From the initial phone calls and information flow coming into the office, it was determined that there was a path or some information that needed to be addressed with the customers. And as more information came in and more pictures, it was evident or apparent that the pest was actually coming in from the rough areas beyond the natural turf or fine turf, manicured turf, and coming in from the outside in. And it was difficult sometimes to tell what that damage was, whether it was drought or other related hosts or pests that were causing the problems.
In Washington, a sod grower observed the winter cutworm moving in from a rough area adjacent to a sod field.
Our first experience with the winter cutworm was in the fall of 2015. We first had some calls in from customers or from homeowners who were experiencing some dieback or some browning in their lawns. These were lawns that had been in for a year and been hydroseeded, and also some newly sodded lawns. And what we were exhibiting in the pictures that they were giving us was a encroaching damage from the edge or the outer edge of the landscape into the lawn. It was not throughout the lawn, it was always from the edge in. And then late in the fall of 2015, we started to experience some of this in a small part of our farm. And it was again this encroaching damage. And we were just starting to learn about the large yellow underwing moth at that time and some of its characteristics. And so the thing that we noticed was in a site like this, not in the actual turf itself, but in a rough or unmanaged site, is where they seem to originate from. And then they moved across a gravel road and started to just encroach on the field. And we probably had about a 9 to 12 inch encroachment and of where they'd come in and defoliated the grass. And it was the same pattern that we saw out in the landscapes, where when you took a closer look at the landscapes, there was a rough or unmanaged area outside the landscape, and then they moved in from there. So it seems to be that in our case that they had defoliated and ate everything that was available to them close by, and then they were looking for a new feeding source, and the lawn was, or the turf that we have, was just 20 feet away.
We don't know how much of a problem the winter cutworm will be, but we all must continue to watch for this pest and its damage. The winter cutworm was not the only insect to be observed causing turf damage in 2015 for the first time in Washington. The European chafer made a very localized appearance in the SeaTac area during 2015. It first came to the United States in the 1940s, entering on the East Coast and making its way across the Midwestern United States. But it wasn't until the early 2000s that the European chafer was identified in the Pacific Northwest, first in British Columbia. Then in 2015, the European chafer was observed causing damage in a homeowner lawn in the SeaTac area and the Portland area too. But there's more to the story. The Washington State Department of Agriculture monitors for the Japanese beetle through a trapping program. How is this program connected to Washington's European chafer story from the past to the future?
So Washington State Department of Agriculture monitors for Japanese beetle across the state every year for quite a while. The Japanese beetle is an introduced species that is firmly established in many of the eastern states. It's an aggressive turf pest, and it's also an aggressive nursery pest as an adult. The turf is fed on by larvae. We monitor across the state, although mostly at airports. Our survey is focused on airport areas because airlines have been shown to be a major pathway for movement of this beetle from the east into the western states. We use pheromone traps. It's part of the USDA's effort to keep the beetle in the east, and it goes along with cargo exclusion devices, which are huge nets that they put around planes in the eastern states that are under quarantine for Japanese beetle to keep the beetle out of planes before they ship things to the west. And our part is simply to monitor them and make sure they don't get here. The European chafer is another introduced scarab pest, another turf pest, also common throughout the eastern states. It is not under an internal quarantine, unlike Japanese beetle, probably because the adults aren't considered as damaging, and so it's less of a risk overall to nursery and landscape trade. In 2001, the European chafer showed up in British Columbia, and it is now widespread throughout the Fraser River Valley. It's causing lots of turf damage, basically doing the exact same thing it does in the eastern states. WSDA did a light trap survey in 2002. Light traps are the preferred method for surveying for European chafer, and we found that it's not in the state. And we haven't surveyed much for it since then. We are lucky in the fact that the Japanese beetle traps also capture European chafer, and so we inspect them frequently for presence of European chafer. In 2008, we did in fact find some, both at SeaTac and at Spokane. That was also a big year for European chafer flights, so they could have just come in on airplanes. In 2015, we did receive alerts from a homeowner who said they had European chafer damage, and it in fact turned out that they do have European chafer damage right here in SeaTac. We don't know quite how widespread the population is, either at the state level or within the city. We're paying a lot closer attention to the JB traps this year to see if we can figure that out.
What does the European chafer look like, and what is its life cycle? What about scouting and management?
The European chafer is a brown beetle about a half inch in length with a large body. In June, it finds a mate, lays eggs, and then dies. The eggs hatch, and then the chafer lives in the soil as a grub. The grub is about 3/4 inch in length. It feeds on the turf grass roots. The grub has 3 visible legs and a dark head as well. In May, the grub turns back into a beetle. The beetle leaves the soil and completes the life cycle of the insect. Similar to the European crane fly, we're trying to catch this insect in its destructive stage, which is in the grub stage down in the soil. So again, we'll use a flat-edged shovel, cutting a 1-foot by 1-foot square down to about a 3-inch depth, inspecting the soil for the European chafer grubs. When we're doing our scouting, the scouting should be done in September or October. If we wait till the spring to do our scouting, the damage that the grub is causing is already done and our turf will die in the summer. So we need to do preventative scouting in the fall rather than scouting in the springtime. As we're doing our scouting in the fall, in September or October, we should be looking for 10 larvae or grub per square foot in poorly maintained turf and 20 larvae per square foot in well-maintained turf. Again, that's turf that receives frequent mowing, frequent fertilization, and summertime irrigation. When we're out scouting, we should also look for drier soil areas. European chafer have a tendency to lay their eggs in drier soils because it provides better survival for their larvae throughout their life cycle. So golf course putting greens, sand-based athletic fields, and areas with soil naturally high in sand are going to be more conducive to European chafer. So when it comes to control of European chafer, before buying and applying insecticides, again, remember to do your scouting, looking for 20 per square feet in well-maintained turf or 10 per square feet in poorly maintained turf. Insecticides should be applied when you're doing your scouting in September or October and not in the spring after the damage of the insect is already done. And select products which are labeled for use of grubs within turf grass.
Billbugs have been causing turf damage in Oregon and Washington for years. They are not a new pest, but they are becoming a more significant and widespread problem, particularly on golf courses.
So billbugs in Oregon are becoming a bigger and bigger problem slowly over time. The normal scenario is a golf course or landscape does not have a problem with billbugs, and then summer rolls around and they've been irrigating an area and they see what looks like drought stress. Eventually they go and check out the turf and they start pulling up turf and it just separates easily from the soil. And then they finally dig and they find very small white insects with orange brownish heads and discover that they're billbugs. As with most turf insects, the larva is what does the damage. The adults are easily identified by their long snout. Billbugs overwinter as adults and become active in March. They lay eggs in the shoots of the plants and the larvae hatch and start chewing in the grass plants down through the crowns. Eventually they fall into the soil and eat the roots, which is why we generally see the first damage in July when drought stress occurs, and people often mistake the damage as drought stress. There are a couple ways to monitor for billbugs. The first and probably most effective is to use a pitfall trap, which is easily constructed by taking a 2-inch piece of irrigation pipe, cutting a slit in the top of it with a skill saw, capping one end, and then running the other end into a yogurt container or some other coffee can or something. And then that gets buried into the soil and a lid goes on the top of it. Then what happens is the billbugs will crawl along the surface, fall in the slit, and then migrate into the container, in which case you can monitor weekly and count how many billbugs are in there. In my work, when I've done the counts, the adults' activity peaked in the third week of May. The second method is to use a soil drench using Joy soap and water. You simply mix, take a couple squirts of Joy soap and put it in water, and then pour the water onto the grass and just wait a few minutes, and the billbugs, if they're there, the adults will come out and you can count them then. One thing to think about when you have billbug problems is to go into the summer with strong turf to begin with by using good fertilizer practices and consistent irrigation. Since the billbugs are eating the roots, the last thing you want to do is apply soluble nitrogen, which will cause a flush of top growth and compromise the roots even more. So there are several strategies for controlling billbugs. First is to target adults. Second is to target the young larvae that are in the stems and are exposed. Third is to target the mature larvae. And fourth is to apply preventatively. Generally, most people will do a preventative app using something like a neonicotinoid or a diamide, which includes ferrets or acelaprin. With the recent problems with neonicotinoids, just be careful about applying them around trees when they're blooming and bees, causing bee damage. In most golf courses where there aren't weeds, that generally isn't a problem. Among the diamides, acelaprin is the only chemical that I'm aware of that is relatively safe on bees. If you have not had billbug problems in the past and you're treating after the larvae have already in the soil, then you need to apply something like 7 that will move through the soil and kill the larvae. Generally, you want to irrigate it in thoroughly, and if there's a lot of thatch, you could even aerify ahead of time. If you continue to have problems with billbugs, one of the options is to plant endophyte-enhanced perennial ryegrass or fine fescue. This will minimize damage as they have compounds in them that the billbugs do not like.
Billbugs are an increasing problem in the Washington golf courses too.
We first started seeing areas of dead turf in the late June, early July of 2010. And I really wasn't sure what it was, but it was it resembled areas that were dead, like we had crane fly damage. You could go up and grab an area of turf and it would just pick right up. It's like it was just, the turf was gnawed off at the crown. So we started digging a little bit and didn't find any crane fly. And after talking to a couple friends that had told me that they'd had billbugs for several years, we started looking a little bit deeper and found them. So we just made some spot treated some of those areas, and it went on from there. Since 2010, it started out in just some localized areas. So for 2011, it came back. They came back about the same time, late June, early July, but in a lot more areas. So we went from just a handful of spots to a couple more handfuls of spots. And so we, same thing, went out and spot treated. This time we saw it in some fairways and some green surrounds. I think in 2012, it even expanded a little bit more. There's more of them this time. Tee surrounds, green surrounds, fairways, and got to the point where now it's the whole golf course. So we've been pretty much having to treat the whole place the last 2 years. The areas where we first saw the billbugs, the grass was longer. So it was mainly in the green and tea surrounds where we mow that grass at an inch and an eighth in height. And then we started seeing them in some fairways, which during the summertime we mow at 0.425, so a little under half an inch. But last year, we finally started seeing some billbug damage in greens. So they moved in from the collar, which is cut at just under half an inch or so, you know, into the greens, which was kind of odd. About 6-7 feet into several of the greens. And that's the first time that I had seen that. So mainly they were just doing their thing on the longer grass. When we first started seeing the billbugs in 2010, I called around to my, you know, friends at other, you know, clubs in the area in greater Seattle, and I only had found one that had the billbugs for 4 or 5 years. Since then, and everybody was kind of, you know, saying, ah, ha, ha, it's just you guys, you know, we don't have that problem. Anyway, it's been spreading. They've showed up at quite a few of the other clubs now, mainly in that first stage like we had it in 2010, where we would just see certain areas. So they've been doing some spot spraying. They haven't quite gotten to the point yet where it's bad enough that they have to apply to the whole golf course, but it has been spreading for sure. The thing is at this golf course, we don't have the liberty of spot spray or just waiting to see what we get. It would be nice not to spend the money and to have to spray the entire golf course, but I can't sit back and just wait for them to wreak havoc on this place and then go out and deal with it. So unfortunately, we've been having to spray the whole golf course the last couple of years.
European crane fly is probably the turf pest that you know the most about.
A little history on the European crane fly. The European crane fly first came to the Pacific Northwest in the 1960s, entering into British Columbia. Then in the 1990s, a second subspecies of the European crane fly was also found in the Pacific Northwest. And it is now widely populated across the western parts of British Columbia, Washington, and Oregon. The adult European crane fly is about 1.5 to 2 inches in size. It is a very thin insect with long legs and a long abdomen and large net vane wings. The European crane fly is an adult in September. It quickly finds a mate, lays eggs, and then dies after laying eggs. The eggs quickly hatch, and then the European crane fly lives in the soil as a maggot known as the leather jacket. The leather jacket is about 1 inch in length and it has no visible legs or visible head, giving it the maggot type appearance. This maggot lives down in the soil, feeding on the turf grass roots for the following 11 months. And then in September, it completes its life cycle, leaving the soil again as an adult to lay more eggs. So when it comes to scouting for the European crane fly, this insect in its destructive stage is a soil-borne insect that lives down in the soil, so we need to scout down in the soil. So we're going to use a flat-end shovel like this to scout for the European crane fly. We're going to dig a 1-foot by 1-foot square down to about a 3-inch depth. We're gonna flip that piece over and then inspect the soil for visible European crane fly. In well-managed turf, this is turf grass that's receiving frequent mowing, fertilization, and irrigation through the summer, the turf can tolerate up to 50 larvae per square foot. However, in poorly managed turf, this is turf that's not being mowed frequently, not being fertilized frequently, and not being irrigated throughout the summer, the action threshold drops significantly down to 25 European crane fly per square feet. While the European crane fly lays its eggs in September, we should be scouting for the insect in December or January. This is about the second or third instar of the insect. It'll be easier to find the large larvae in the soil. The mistake is to wait till the following spring to do our scouting, because at that point, the damage of the insect will already be done. For control of European crane fly, this insect prefers to lay its eggs in moist environments. The eggs need moisture to survive. So if we can do anything to dry up the soil, like install drain tiles, install catch basins, core cultivate and sand top dress, or decrease irrigation rates in September, we can minimize insect activity. When it comes to pesticide applications, we can apply products like 7, Tall Star, Electus, or Aloft in December and January when we're scouting and observing our action thresholds of 25 in poorly maintained turf and 50 per square feet in well-maintained turf. Remember to always scout and observe your action thresholds before making your pesticide applications.
Over the past couple decades, there was a lot of lawn problems misdiagnosed as European crane fly by homeowners and turf professionals. Most of the lawn samples sent to the WSU Puyallup Diagnostic Laboratory as suspected crane fly were not European crane fly. Usually, there was no insect or disease causing the problem. But during 2015, there were a lot more lawn problems caused by the crane fly. Now we will see what happens this year and in the future. While managing turf in your job or your yard, remember to be keen observers. When you see a problem, make certain to get an accurate diagnosis of what is causing the problem. Know how to scout for potential problems. Prevent problems by keeping the turf healthy with proper cultural techniques, mowing, fertilization, irrigation, and aeration. Use effective turf IPM strategies.